That was Tamas to start, and not sure you have worked at this title. It's about art galleries, and,
yeah.
And it's a very interesting stuff. And please start. You use the board, so probably you need
that. Yes, I want to use it. Okay. So thank you for coming. I'll talk about art galleries. So let's start historically. So in 1973, Victor Klee asked how many guards are needed to control an art gallery. What's an art gallery? It's a simple polygon in two dimensions. And what does controlling mean? We want to place guards inside or on the edges the vertices, some guards, so that any point of the gallery is visible by some guards. So, for example, this looks like a good choice for a set of guards. This very simple example. And the first proof for this theorem came in 1975 by Kotal. And I'll prove that first to get some basic grammar on these theorems first. So, first we should try to come up with a lower bound, and of course that is my example. So let's take I can call this a cone with k prongs.
Sorry, what was the statement of the theorem?
I haven't stated it yet.
Okay, sure.
We will state it together. So, okay. So let's say you take a comb with k prongs. Now, of course, we need a guard placed in each of these prongs. There's no guard to see both prongs at the same time, two prongs at the same time. So, this has 3k vertices and needs k guards. So we need at least this many guards to cover n vertex polygon. And the theorem is that this is sharp. This example is sharp. So, or in other words,
so the proof starts by orthogonal and vertices. So I believe everybody believes that the polygon can be triangulated, right? Okay. And now, now that it's triangulated, oh, that's actually not the triangulation. So triangulation, of course, uses only the vertices of the polygon, so no Steiner points. And so if we have triangulation, then I claim that it's dual graph. That is, when if we add a vertex for each face of the triangulation, and we connect two nodes by an edge, if they share, if their respective triangles share a side, then this graph is of course connected, and it is a tree. Why is it a tree? Well, suppose it contains a cycle. If it contains a cycle, the dual graph. So suppose the dual graph contains a cycle. Yes. Then, well, I don't know exactly how it looks like, but some vertices of the original polygon must be inside the, well, if we, of course, draw the edges of this cycle in the dual graph, in the plane, then some vertices of the triangulation graph will be inside this cycle. That means that some outside vertices will be also inside this cycle, because the vertex is on the boundary of the polygon. So, but then it means that the polygon was not simply connected. So that's a contradiction. Okay. So now that we know this, it's going to be really easy to prove that the triangulation graph is three-colorable. And the proof is by simple induction. You can always find a leaf in the dual graph of the triangulation graph and delete it. By the induction hypothesis, you can three-color the vertices of this smaller polygon such that its triangulation graph is three-colorable. And then, when you reattach this last triangle, then it has two colors on two of its vertices, and of course you can choose the third color for the third vertex. And now all you have to realize is that, of course, a triangle, if it's three-colored, then its vertices intersect each color class. So that means that the smallest color class will be a good choice for the set of cards. And now, it's easy to see that the smallest color class has size at most n over 3, 4. So, yeah. So this was a nice combinatory proof. And what you can also see from this is that you not only get a guarding, you get some a bit more structure than that. So it's not just a cover, you also get a partition. To say you chose the red color class, then you assign these fans that are around the red vertices. This will give a partition of the polygon. So say this is red. Then of course all these vertices are not red. And all of the triangles have red vertex, so they belong to one of the fans. I call this a fan. So we can partition the polygon into regions that can be one guarded, that are guardable by one guard. And throughout this presentation, I will try to convince you that this holds for different types of artillery theorems too. So this is interesting because, by definition, an artillery theorem problem is, or an artillery problem is a coverage problem. But somehow, all of these theorems will have a partition theorem behind them, or at least we also. Okay. So in the abstract, I wrote that there exist many variations on this problem, and so we had. Well, simple polygons and, say, fixed guard. So far. And now, I want to restrict how the art gallery can look like. If you've been to an art gallery, then it most likely was an orthogonal art gallery, meaning that... So, meaning that the sides of the polygon are axis parallel. So the question is, can we say more? And the answer is yes. And so let's first try to construct a lower bound. So what would it be? How could we adapt this example to the orthogonal setting? We'll how could an orthogonal cone look like?
We'll take a rectangle.
Yeah. And so on. So again, if there are K prongs, then we have 4K vertices, and of course we need to put a guard in each of these prongs. So we need at least a number of 4 guards. And indeed, the theorem by Kahn, Lava, and says that n over 4 guards are sometimes necessary. I'm not good at allocating space. Sometimes necessary. And sufficient to control orthogonal simple polygon. And I'll just refer to these as polynomials. So the first proof by Kantar and Feta, I think, yeah, 8, was about 13, 14 pages, and it used quadrilateralizations, meaning that they proved that any polynomial can be quadrilateralized. So it can be partitioned into quadrilaterals. And then you can do a very similar proof.
Into what?
Quadrilaterals.
Okay.
And
Do you need convex or
no?
No. Okay. No. Yeah. So this proof is a bit complicated, although. But so I wouldn't be able to tell you this long proof, but I can tell you a shorter proof.
By the inside quadrilateral, you might be more than one guard.
No. You can always. Oh, you can put it in the middle.
Yeah.
Well, so the proof is not the same as here. It's, but the main idea is that there is a quadrilateral relation. But I can prove a nicer theorem. Actually, it's not my theorem. It's a theorem of Ervin, 85-ish.
I think probably.
Yeah. And it says that a polygonal. Of vertices can be partitioned into at most n over 4 lower polynomials of at most 6 vertices. So, this theorem of course implies the above one. Why? Because a 6 polynomial can always be guarded by one guard. 6 polynomials are basically L shapes, and 4 polynomials are rectangles. That's quite clear. So this is a much stronger theorem, and fortunately this has a much nicer proof. Or maybe it's not fortunately, it's because it grasps the inner workings of these theorems better. So, okay, so the implication is clear. The proof now. So, we want to use induction on the number of vertices. So we want to somehow separate the polynomial into two pieces such that we can invoke the induction hypothesis on both parts. So we need to cut the polynomials into two somehow. And most of the times, a randomly chosen cut works, but not always. So, suppose we have something like this. There are two concave vertices that can be connected by a line segment that is entirely inside the polygon, or inside the polynomial. Then we create two parts of M1 and M2 vertices, and fortunately, and this holds, we do not create three vertices, so this of course implies that this holds, so if by the induction hypothesis, we partition this polynomial into n1 over 4 lower polynomials, and do the same thing for this polynomial, then their union will be a good partition for the whole polynomial. So, that's good.
But what happens if we do not have these lucky dots? So then we'll have something like this. Or maybe we also sometimes need to use such L-shaped cuts. So I've got these like single cuts and L-shaped cuts, and these are the double cuts. So in this case, we may run into problems because we create two more vertices in total. And then there could be a problem. So if if the modulo 4 remainder of n is 2, and the modulo 4 remainder of n1 and n2 is 0, then we have a problem. Then this equation does not hold. And we cannot do induction. However, and this is the only bad case, basically. Not, it is the only bad case. So, what can we do now? Okay, say we start sweeping by line parallel to the y-axis, then eventually we'll hit our polygonal. And we'll find two convex vertices connected by an edge. And we'll use that there are no double cuts anymore. So if this is the case, then I'll draw it like this. Then we do not have too many options on how we could draw this. But what we'll do is, when we found this, I think it's called a knob, these two convex vertices connected by an edge, then we start pushing this edge down into the polynomial. And we stop when we hit the boundary again. And we have only a few cases, either something like this happens, that we hit a wall that is inside the polynomial, but then it's very easy to see that we can only hit one wall. If we have two walls, then we have a double cut. So when we stop, it either is one wall, or maybe it's a one-sided wall, or this happens, or it very well may be that there is no opening on this edge. So something like this will happen, and we'll have to elaborate on this case a bit more. Okay, so now I claim that if I'm in case A, then one of these cuts work. Why is that? Well, if this part of the polynomial has n1 vertices, then I claim that to the left of this cut, we have n1 plus 2 vertices. And then, of course, both cuts cannot satisfy this equation of the remainder. Okay, so this case is clear. In this case there has to be an opening. And so we simply have, again, two consecutive cuts. Consecutive because
Sorry.
Yeah.
What happens for a case down? Maybe down there are some vertex.
Down.
Yes, between of these two.
This is outside. So this is the inside of the polynomial.
Ah, okay.
And this is already outside. So we hit the boundary again. So that has to be outside.
Maybe something this happened.
So it's simply connected. So we cannot have.
There cannot be a hole in this.
Yeah.
Why?
We don't have holes. I'm not dealing with holes in this presentation.
Can I ask one?
Sure. Please.
Yeah, but it's still on the right side, so.
That's okay. Let's draw something like this.
Still divided by two parts.
So, this is this polynomial here. Has 8 vertices.
Yes.
So it's not necessarily
good
to cut it off, but this part has 10 vertices. So its remainder is 2 modulo 4. So in this case, this would be a good cut.
Okay.
All right, so same thing can be done in case B. Again, there has to be openings on both sides, and they cannot be on the same level because we have double cuts. So, but that's not important. Anyway, so again, we can find 2 consecutive cuts. And in this case, well, if something like this happens, then we found a 6 polynomial. That's always good. Or, and this is one case, but it very well may be that something like this is the case. Well, then either, then we start pushing this small segment in. And when we hit, if we hit a convex vertex, a concave vertex, if we hit a concave vertex first, then we can have. Oh no, we don't need that. Then we have again a 6 polynomial. And lastly, we may hit a ball again here. But then we have our 2 consecutive cuts. And basically, these are all the cases. So, we either always found a 6 polynomial that we can cut off, or we found 2 consecutive cuts, so that one of them has to have the right remainder. Okay. Alright. By the way, this theorem can be proved without these L-shaped cuts. So we only need straight cuts. But that proof is much more difficult than this one. And furthermore, Hoffman proved in 1991 that actually in a traditional, in a traditional art gallery that is an orthogonal one, you can even have like multiple levels, meaning that there is a staircase, and then you can go up a level, come back down, and so on, and still the same bound walls.
So,
yeah?
What are the number of vertices then? Like, we have different floors now,
mm-hmm.
Right? So
it's still connected. It might, so even holes are allowed.
Uh-huh.
Well, Oh, maybe I'm wrong about the multiple, but okay, I'll start over. So we don't need to interconnect it in orthogonal, in the orthogonal case. There is a theorem about multiple levels too, but that's not very good to test. Okay.
This theorem, partition theorem, or just guard theorem?
This partition theorem only holds with 16, but that also holds. But you can partition into 16 polynomials that can be vanguarded. Those look something like this. You have rectangles that are all intersecting each other in one vertex. Okay. All right. Now, I want to talk about what happens if we modify the power of the guards. So, mobile guards. First, let's go back to simple polygons. So there's a theorem by Paul Rucker, 1993, that n over 4 mobile guards, what's a mobile guard? Mobile guard is a guard that can patrol a line segment inside the polynomial. And then he has vision at all vertices, at all points of this interior line segment. Yeah. So n over 4 mobile guards are sufficient to cover a simple polygon of n vertices. Yes, and the proof of this theorem also uses triangulations. And it's combinatorial, by the way, meaning that, so the guards are combinatorial, meaning that they only need vision at the end of their patrols. And so this proof is also, in some sense, a partition theorem. It's also used a partition theorem.
What about lower bound?
Oh, good question. So, if you take a few hooks, each hook contains 4 vertices, and you would need at least, well, you would need like a something like a 2 guard. You need a... So, a mobile guard cannot guard this and this point at the same time. So you need to add a mobile guard for each hoop. Basically, this is the old one. Yeah. Okay. So what do we know so far? So far we have following. So we can have a simple polygon. Polynomial. Offset fixed guard. So we saw that this is n over 3, 4. We also proved this, and we also prove this. Well, we haven't proved it, but we've seen it all around. And so the natural question is, what goes here? So one would hope that if we go in this direction, we need roughly 3/4 as many guards. If we go in this direction, we need roughly 3/4 as many guards. Well, this is almost true, but only roughly. So now we go back to polynomials and mobile cards. So I'll draw something that looks very familiar. And you can continue in the same fashion. So this is, these are a chain of swastikas. So you can continue here. So what if we take K swastikas? What happens? Again, we have that. So on. These points cannot be seen by one mobile guard at the same time. So, and how many vertices does this have? I claim that this has n equals 16k plus 4. So, one swastika has 20 vertices, and whenever we add another swastika to it, then destroy 4 vertices, and so on. So this is the number of vertices, and if we look at the number of guards needed, so we need a guard in each of these arms, and it has 3k plus 1 arms. And you can check that the relation between these two numbers is 3 times n plus 4 over 16. So the rule I said that you need roughly 3/4 as many, it does hold, but we have this disgusting 4 here. And, well, it's disgusting because it causes a lot of problems when you want to prove this theorem. And so in this form, it was proved by Agarwal in 86, I'm hoping, that n plus 4 over 16 for mobile guards are sufficient to cover a n polynomial. And the reason I said cover, because this proof does only prove a cover, unfortunately. So, for example, it might happen that two guards have intersecting patrols in the construction that, in the set of guards that this, the proof of this theorem gives. And also, yes?
I think it's not different, it doesn't make any difference, but should the guards be parallel?
Yes. So you can prove that in this theorem, the way it's proved, it only uses vertical and horizontal guards. Yes, but what I wanted to say is that the general mobile guard theorem for simple polygons constructs spectrals so that only vision at the end of the spectrals is required. But here, this is not known, so the guards may have to look around many times during their patrols. They have to stop and so on. But, as I told you in the beginning, so far, most archaeological theorems had a partition theorem proof too. So for all three of these we had that. But it was not known for this for the polyomyelic mobile guards. And I claim that even that is true. So the theorem is that a polynomial and vertices can be partitioned into at most 3n+4/16 polynomials of at most 8 vertices. Why 8 vertices? Because if we take any polynomial of 8 vertices, it can be guarded by one mobile guard. So this theorem is much, much stronger than Agarwal's proof, and it's also much shorter. This is about 20-something pages, 23, and this has about 30-page proof.
And now it's enough to control in 2 points.
Exactly. And not only that, but because it's a partition, the petrols are not intersecting. So this result is much, much deeper. Okay, I will not be able to prove this in the remaining 10 minutes, but I'll share with you a few ideas that we use to prove this theorem. So as I said earlier, that plus 4 causes lots of problems. So it's not true anymore that any double cut is a good cut, meaning that it separates the polynomial into two parts so that so we want this to hold. But we need more. So even if we have a double cut, and we need that the modulo 16 remainders, so they have to be restricted. And over there we have star added plus 2. Then we need that 2, 8, 14. Yes, so this is what, this is an easy analysis.
Sorry, is that congruent or not congruent?
This is congruent.
Okay.
It's just easier to say it this way. Yeah. Yes. So, for example, if, so this is a polygon of how many? I think 10 vertices. So 3 times 10 plus 4, that's 34 over 16, so 4, so that's 2. We want to, we want to prove that this can be partitioned into 2 polynomials of at most 8 vertices. And so for example, this is not what I wanted, sorry. No, this was for an earlier one. No. That example. Okay, so for example here we have a double cut, but this is not really a good cut. So this has, I think, 14 vertices. And if we cut this off, this rectangle, then we still have a polynomial of 10 vertices. So this is not a good cut, even though it's a double cut. And it used to be good, but it's not anymore because of the plus 4. And it doesn't hold anymore that we only need straight cuts. So we really need the L-shaped cuts. This is, for example, a good. This is, and this example needs L-shaped cuts. No straight cuts are sufficient. Okay, but instead of 2 consecutive cuts, if you have 3 consecutive cuts, then one of the parts sizes will intersect one of these remainder classes. And so, for example, we might have, say, so for example, if we have something like this, so for example, in this case, we have this cut. Oh no, let's begin. This cut. Okay, this is the first cut. Then if we cut straight here, then that's plus 2 vertices. And if you cut this way, then that's again plus 2 vertices. So we have such cases in the proof, and this is an example of that. So if we have something like this, then we have 3 consecutive cuts. But there are many technical difficulties. So we might have these corridors that we need to deal with somehow. This is actually the first part of the proof, somehow getting rid of this. And it can be done, and it's not really interesting. But what's interesting is that this proof is shorter and is more combinatory than our last proof. And so I'm hoping that I was able to convince you more or less that partition theorems are a good way to tackle Algebraic theorems. And I would like to thank you for your attention.